Hey guys, happy Wednesday. So this is going to be a quick but powerful word. I have notes on my phone, but I also have notes that I wrote down this morning as I was studying this dream and just allowing God to download to me and put the pieces together. So let's just get right into it. Welcome to those of you that are new to Bold for Christ. Just make sure God sent you here and you didn't send yourself. I am just the vessel, a faulty vessel at that. So never put your trust in me before God. Don't put your trust in man before God. I am just a vessel here to relay a word that God places on my heart, and it's your job to take it back to God and to seek him for further revelation. Never idolize prophetic voices, ministers, evangelists, whatever people want to call themselves. Always keep God first. Okay. I know who I am. I know what God has called me to do, but it's your job to still take these words to the Lord and say, is this from you? Is this for me? What does this mean? Okay. Never put anybody above God. But nevertheless, let's get into this word. Happy Wednesday. If I didn't say that already, happy hump day. I hope you guys are having a good day. I'm supposed to do a podcast today, and right now it is still on for 8 p.m. Central Standard Time. So I did post a reminder, or the podcast live is already scheduled. So if you haven't turned on your notifications, make sure your notifications are on so that you can tune into the live 8 p.m. Central Standard Time. This is a podcast that God put on my heart in a dream. He actually gave me the name for this podcast in a dream. It is called In My White Tea. You can read more about what this podcast is going to entail, or what this in general. Okay. Because each episode will be different, but I did do a community post just to give you guys an overview of what In My White Tea is about and what God is calling me to do with it. So the first episode will premiere tonight on live with my sister in Christ, whose name is also Christina. And this podcast is just to bring encouragement to people by showing imperfect people and what God is doing in their lives and how they're navigating these different chapters, these different seasons. And a lot of seasons are hard. When you choose to say yes to God, that cross is heavy, and people don't like to talk about the hard stuff. They want to talk about everything once they're blessed and past it, but we want to catch people exactly where they are. So it's about bringing a bunch of imperfect people on to Alive, to this podcast, to just share what's on their heart, the things that they struggle with, the things that they go through, the things that God is taking them through, so that you don't feel alone in this walk. Okay, so catch me tonight at 8 p.m. Central Standard Time. I feel like it's going to be such an encouraging message for so many of you. And because it's live, we'll also be able to take questions from the live and allow Christina to answer your questions and so forth. So this first episode is kind of like a Christina times Christina episode, because my name is Christina too, even though I go by Nina, but I'm excited about it. Just bringing brothers and sisters in Christ on, and we're going to share everything that they struggle with, whatever God is taking them through, with you guys, and just be completely honest, open, and transparent about this walk and this life and how everyone's journey is different. But trust and believe that if you said yes to God, everybody is struggling in one area or another. The difference is we have God, and we will never fall. We will never faint. He will always catch us. He will always strengthen us. But we definitely are not exempt from everyday issues. We just have a God that places a solid foundation under our feet so that we do not fall. We will not faint. We will make it regardless. Our end result is a win, because God has never lost a battle. So tune into that if you haven't. Again, I did do a community post, so that'll give you a little bit more insight on how In My White Tea came about and what it entails and so forth. So check us out tonight for that. But let's go ahead and get into this word. So what the Lord is saying by this dream, and he gave me this dream a week or so ago. He's saying, be mindful of who's backing you. Okay. Be mindful of who's backing you. Okay. Translation, be careful of who you see as being your close friend, your confidant, your counselor that has your back. Because a lot of people that many of you think has your back, they've been doing nothing but holding you back. You just haven't paid attention to come to an understanding of that. Okay, so as we navigate the seasons ahead and walk into this new and whatever season or era God has you in, it's so important to be mindful of who you are surrounded by. Okay, because Satan uses people. Satan is not after your car. He cannot drive your car. He is not after your house. He cannot live in your house. Okay. He is not after the material things. Okay. He comes to steal, kill, and destroy. He wants your life. Okay. He wants your life. He wants you to give up on God. He wants people to turn their backs on God, because once people turn their backs on God, they start living a dark life and they partner with him. And that is what he wants. He comes to kill, steal, and destroy. And he does that by using people. And Satan appears as light. Okay, so when he uses people, certain people in your life will appear as light. You'll think that they're there for you. They have your back, but God has given you the ability to ask for an increase of discernment, to ask for an increase of wisdom, to ask for an increase of knowledge so that God can show you the things that you cannot see. Because one thing about God, he can see the heart of people. We cannot. That is why it's so important to have relationship with God, because you may be thinking, oh, this person's so nice. They're okay. They pray for me. They speak in tongues. Meanwhile, their tongues aren't real. Okay. They're just making up words. The prayers that they're putting up, they're not praying for you. They're praying on you. P-R-E-Y, not P-R-A-Y. And it's a whole different ball game, but God can see the hearts of people. And trust and believe, when you ask God to show you the hearts of people, he will show you. Be ready for what he shows you too. Because a lot of the times he shows you people's hearts and you're like, oh no, not her, Lord. Not him. He's so nice. They're so nice. And God is like, they're not for you. One thing about God is he sits higher than you. So he can see what we can't see, right? And I spoke on this particular thing before, how people will say, God is not a God of confusion. No, he is not. But a lot of the things God takes us through, that he allows us to go through, a lot of the things that God allows into our lives, and some of the things he causes, right? Nothing can happen under the sun without God, one, causing it, or two, allowing it, one or the other. Best believe that nothing happens, good or bad, to where God is like, oh, that caught me off guard. He either causes it or he allows it. He does not cause everything, right? So you see someone walk into a schoolhouse and shoot up a school, that's not of God. He didn't cause that. But he will allow these things to happen. Why? At the end of the day, it's for his glory. I'm not God, so I can't answer those questions, but there's nothing under this sun that can happen without God either causing it or allowing it to happen, because nothing can bypass him. He runs the show. Regardless of what Satan has some people thinking, God runs the show. He allows the rich to be rich and the poor to be poor. God controls everything. Even with this whole people have free will. Free will does not override God, okay? He still controls every single thing. Okay, a man may plan his ways, but God what? Orders those steps, okay? So free will does not override God. So no, God is not a God of confusion, but his ways and the things that he allows or the things that he does will often confuse us, because he sits higher than us. We're only mere humans. We will never understand God in his fullness. He's too great for us. So no, he's not a God of confusion. Just like his word says, he's not a God of confusion. He's not confused by anything, but we will be looking at God sideways, like what is happening, because we're confused. And that's simply because God sits higher than us. We are never going to understand him in his fullness. We only even prophesy in part. Okay, so his ways and the way he moves will confuse us, because a lot of the times we don't understand it. But we're way below God's pay grade, which is why we don't understand a lot. He's God. He's the only God, right? If you guys remember, he gave me an example in a previous word of how to explain this to you guys. And God is so smart and strategic. He was saying it's like a doctor or a surgeon. that comes in to give you a diagnosis or to tell you what your test results say, right? And the doctor is using all of this medical terminology and this medical jargon and these big words. And you're looking at the doctor like, can you simplify that for me? Because I don't know what you just said. So then the doctor will break down what they just said in simplified terms, right? So that you can understand what they're saying. But if that doctor is explaining a test result or your diagnosis to another doctor and they're using medical terminology and big words and so forth, the other doctor is going to understand him because they're on the same level. They're both doctors. So what's confusing to you as you're listening to a doctor use these big words and medical terminology and all of this jargon is not going to confuse somebody that's on that doctor's level, honey. They got the same education. They were trained the same way. So it's not going to be confusing for another doctor to hear it, but it will be confusing to you because you didn't go to school to be a doctor. The language is foreign to you. So you have to look at God's ways just like that. We're not on God's pay grade. We would need a lot of education and all the things to get on God's level, and we still wouldn't be there. So when God is moving things around, we will always be confused. He will shed light on the areas in due time, but we're not going to immediately just understand God's ways and what he's doing because we're not on his level. He is the great physician. So even a regular physician will not understand God. God is not on our level. So no, he's not a God of confusion, but his ways will confuse us because we sit lower than him. Okay? So God is saying, be mindful of who's backing you. Be mindful of who you think has your back. And this is going to be very important, not just for this season or this era that you're walking in, but for this journey overall, okay? Darkness and principalities in high places is real, okay? What's done in the spiritual realm will eventually play out in the light, in the natural, okay? So if you have people operating in darkness and you think they're backing you, but meanwhile, they're behind your back doing witchcraft and praying against you and so forth. God is your shelter. He will Psalms 91 protect you. But these people that you've opened the door to or allowed in will cause unnecessary warfare. And what they do on the dark side in the spiritual realm, this witches, warlocks, witchcraft, all that stuff, they do it in order for it to play out in the natural. Okay, Satan comes to kill, steal, and destroy, but he does it through people. Okay, and this will make more sense with the dream. So, and I'm reading from my notes, guys. So I had this dream a week ago and I was in a car and there was a girl. I was in a car driving, right? I was driving straight ahead and there was this girl sitting in the back seat and she was sitting directly behind my seat. So directly behind the driver's seat. And she started dropping little balls of cotton behind my back. So I wasn't sitting all the way back to the seat. I was sitting kind of upward. So there was a space between me and the seat, even though I'm driving. And she was sitting behind me in the back seat, dropping little cotton balls behind my back in the seat, right? And I immediately knew in the dream that she was doing witchcraft, right? That was the end of the dream, okay? So this is how the Lord broke this down. Me sitting in the driver's seat of the car, God is saying that he's placed you, whoever this word is for, he's placed you in a seat of authority and control, allowing you to take charge of your life in certain areas or specific situations as he leads you, okay? As he guides you, but he's giving you a seat of authority. He's given you a seat of authority. Okay, and he's allowing you to take charge in this area, in this specific part of your life as he's leading you, but he's also put you in a seat of leadership, okay? The woman in the back seat of this car represents someone or people, as in more than one person, that do not have direct control in your life, but they are there to influence or manipulate you from behind the scenes. Okay, so this is not a person that you've given control or free reign over your life in any way, but this is someone that you've allowed to get close to you and they are able to manipulate things behind the scenes because you've opened the door for this person to be a part of your life in one way or another. Okay, the cotton balls symbolize a deceptive softness or an attempt to cushion you in a way that feels comforting to you, but has underlying motives. Hence, me recognizing that what they were doing was witchcraft. Okay, so even though she's taking cotton balls and dropping it behind my seat, cotton is soft, right? Cotton is really soft. Our pillows are filled with cotton. When we put on a blanket, most blankets are made of cotton. It's very soft and comforting, okay? So the cotton symbolizes a deceptive softness or an attempt to cushion you in a way that feels comforting to you, but it has underlying motives, witchcraft, okay? So whoever this person or these people are, you're comfortable around them. They don't seem like the type that will harm you or do witchcraft on you or do things behind the scenes. There is a comfort there. They make you feel comfortable, okay? They cushion you in a sense, okay? You have this softness towards them. God is giving you the ability to discern what is being done around you, even when it's being done in a subtle way, in order for the true motive to be concealed. Okay, dropping cotton balls behind my back, cotton when it's falling in the seat or anywhere else, it does not make noise. Y'all better catch this on a spiritual level. So God is giving you the ability to discern, just like in the dream, I knew it was witchcraft. He's giving you the ability to discern what's being done around you, what's being done behind your back, what's being done, even though you may not be able to see anything. He's letting you know what's being done behind the scenes, okay? Even when it's being done in a subtle way, a way that's quiet, a way that's comforting, a way that doesn't seem obvious, okay? Overview. The Lord is saying there is someone in your life, your circle, in your personal space, as you navigate this journey that God has put before you in this seat of authority that seeks to manipulate and work against you as you navigate this journey. They appear to have your back. They appear harmless, but in reality, it's the exact opposite. The placement of cotton behind your back is their attempt to hinder your progress and cause discomfort in your life in a way that's not immediately obvious. The Holy Spirit, the Spirit of God, is going before you and revealing to you what's happening behind the scenes and nudging you to take notice. The Lord is prompting you to remain vigilant about the influences in your life that you think are there to help you, but in reality, they have ulterior motives. Pray and seek God in this hour so that he can give you clarity, wisdom, and guidance on how to move forward and what to do next. His guidance and protection will keep you on the right path despite spiritual interference, witchcraft. Witchcraft is spiritual harm that causes natural harm. Okay, witchcraft is spiritual harm. It's done in the spirit, but it causes natural harm. The Lord is telling you to discern and be vigilant about what's going on around you. And the only way for you to do that is to stay connected to God as he guides you, as he navigates you. I was driving this car. The Lord is saying he's put you in a seat of authority. He has you moving forward in life. He's navigating with you. But there are people or a person in specific, okay, in particular, that is working behind the scenes, witchcraft. Again, witchcraft is done in the spiritual realm. It's darkness in the spiritual realm, and they do it in order for it to transpire, to translate, to pull over, to transfer into the natural. It's to harm you. And y'all know God speaks to me in parables, so the whole dream was a parable, but he broke that down, okay? He broke that down for whoever this is for. The Lord is saying, be vigilant and seek him in this hour, okay? And for many of you, you're going to immediately know who the Lord is speaking of in your life because this is going to wholly nudge you in a way that's very powerful. So you will immediately know who this person is, okay? Pray, cover yourselves, okay? Close the door to this person, but pray. You have power in the tongue. There's life and death in your tongue and how you speak. God has given you dominion over darkness. He's given you the ability to trample on serpents. So anything Satan tries to throw at you, any darkness that comes against you, you're able to defeat it by the power of God. Speak a thing. Okay. Many of you will know exactly who God is referring to, either this particular person or more than one person, but you're going to know exactly who this is. Some of you may get a holy nudge. God may convict your heart. So you know this is for you, but seek him and ask him who it is. I had to do it. I'm like, God, who is it? Who is it in my life? And as I was studying this word this morning, I just began to go into prayer and cover myself because I know God is moving me forward. I know that there's a propelling forward and I know that this is coming swiftly and quickly. I can see the movement. Okay. So I need to know who's around me, who's on my side, who's not on my side, but God sits higher than me. He can see the hearts of people. You can take this back to Judas. Okay, Judas was a betrayer. The Lord God knew and also Jesus knew that he was a betrayer, but he was put in that group for purpose. But none of the disciples that also walked in this group with Jesus and this betrayer knew that the betrayer would be Judas. But Jesus knew the entire time. God knew the entire time. He placed Judas in his son's circle. Because there was a purpose that had to take place, okay? But none of the disciples were able to discern this. When Jesus was like, someone's gonna betray me at this table, the disciples didn't know who he was talking about. And they had been around this person the whole entire journey with Jesus. You would think that they had some inkling or, okay, I caught this, I was able to discern, it's him. They knew nothing. And many of you are just like the disciples. This person has been in your circle this whole time and you know nothing. You're completely oblivious to what's been going on. But one thing about this is that your Father God is not oblivious. The Lord Jesus is not oblivious to people. He can see the heart. He does not look at the outer like we do. He does not judge by the outer appearance. He looks at the heart and he can see if the heart is deceitful or wicked, or if the heart is righteous and full of goodness. He can see all of it. Seek him in this hour because you can't afford for unnecessary darkness to come against you. Yes, there are sometimes, just like with Judas, that was allowed to be in Jesus's circle to fulfill a purpose. So there are times where God will allow a betrayer in our circle that pushes us into purpose. I have a whole nother word on that. But there are times where we open doors unknowingly and we're fighting unnecessary warfare and darkness and can't figure out why we're fighting it or where it's coming from. Whoever this word is for, the Lord is saying that person is in your circle. You're wondering why you're fighting witches and warlocks and warfare and all the things. And it's someone that you're around. It's someone in your circle. They're in the background. You think they have your back and they're supporting you, but they're literally throwing witchcraft your way in a very subtle way. And you're not going to notice. Because they're not making a sound. Cotton does not make a sound. But the Lord is giving you the ability to discern what's going on around you. He's giving you a high level of wisdom and knowing and knowledge of what's going on. Seek him and ask him. He will not withhold any good thing from you. That's not just for blessings. It's also for safety, to keep you safe. He wants you to prosper. He wants to keep you safe, but sometimes we unknowingly open doors. You can also look at Absalom, David's son. When David was king, Absalom was all for him, on his side, doing the most, but then he switched gears and he started to go against his father. He wanted his father's position. He wanted to be king. So he was telling the people how he can do a better job than David and get them the justice they need and all of these things. He started to go against his father. He was once all for David, but his own son started to betray him. And then also, what's this man's name? Hold on. Ahithophel. I think that's how you pronounce his name. Ahithophel. Who was David's trusted advisors, a really close friend of David, right? He was really close. He served King David faithfully. But then he started to be on Absalom's side. And he started to counsel Absalom, David's son, on how to defeat David, even though he started out as one of David's most trusted counselors. He was like a close friend to David. But here he is counseling David's son on how to take David's spot, how to kill David off, how to get rid of David. Right? Seek God in this hour, whoever this is for. Seek God in this hour, because this is somebody that you've opened the door to, that you've trusted, but God is seeing otherwise. So this is a warning. You don't need this unnecessary weight holding onto you as God is propelling you forward into the new, as he's driving you forward into this new season. You don't need dead weight holding onto you. You don't need to be fighting unnecessary warfare because of a door that you opened. Again, David's son turned on him. David's close counselor turned on him and started coaching his son. Come on now. And y'all can read this in scripture. If in Psalms 41:9, many scholars, biblical scholars, believe that David was talking about his trusted counselor, Ahithophel, or however you say his name. I think it's Ahithophel. In Psalms 41:9, when David says, even my close friend, someone I trusted who shared my bread, has turned against me. Somebody is sharing your bread and turning against you, and you're just allowing them to ride along. They're in the back seat. So God is saying, seek him so that he can lead you in the way that you should go in this hour. So that's the word, guys. I will see you guys later on the live, which is, again, the first episode of In My White Tea. But this is for somebody, very short, very powerful, but very important in this hour. Okay. I love y'all. I hope you have a great day, and we'll talk soon. Bye, guys.